you know, there was always this, here comes the SEC, here comes the prideful Tiger LSU program, here comes the fan base that is so passionate about football and LSU, and all of that played out, right? I mean, it was a sea of purple and gold that kind of crashed down in LA. But going out there, I will say that I was a bit surprised of just the enthusiasm around UCLA, the stadium, the environment, the backing, the people, the fans, the, you know, all of kind of went into it. I thought I was going to see kind of what exists seemingly now, where it's just total non-relevance. People aren't paying attention. There's not a lot of support. There doesn't feel like there's a lot of backing, passion behind UCLA's brand right now. I mean, if you were to YouTube Deshaun Foster's press conference leading into this game, which happened 2 days ago, comparison, Brian Kelly spoke to the media on Monday on the LSU channel, on the LSU sports channel. Brian Kelly's press conference has over 12,000 views, and that's just at LSU sports. Yeah. You got to imagine, it's been picked up all other places. It was watched live. It was attended by a seating room
gaggle
of press that was around probably 40 to 50 members deep that asked 20 minutes worth of questions that then went and published that all over the country. 48 hours since Deshaun Foster spoke about the LSU game, it has 792 views on YouTube.
Yeah, 400 of them.
Like, and I got to imagine that the media that I just talked about at LSU probably accounts for about a third of that, of just trying to find information, get news, get. And when I tell you it's one of the more depressing, one of the more sad, one of the more just we give up type feel press conference that I've seen, it's hard to describe on just how tapped out UCLA football seems right now. I mean, to see what's happened since LSU left there 4 years ago, where you've got Chip Kelly in control, seemingly trying to kind of put the program in the right direction and bring it apart, the, you know, bring it atop the mountain of the Pac-12. And now, first year in the Big Ten to see it a bottom dweller. I mean, I don't know how they win a game, really. Indiana just went there across the country last week and beat them like a drum at the Rose Bowl.
Indiana's good.
I know they're good. I know they're good.
Sneaky good.
But it's still UCLA football at home in week three. You know, like getting beat by four scores by an Indiana team.
7 years ago.
You know, I mean, it's...
I mean, I'm looking at their Twitter right now, and they are trying. They're putting out clips. 6 likes on a player clip. 6 likes on a player clip. Of media, like talking to the media. And I think, look, I understand that it's not like out of sight, out of mind kind of deal, because if your head coach leaves the way that Chip Kelly did, like at the stroke of midnight, and then just leaves the program into nobody's hands, that gives you the thought of where UCLA football is. Like, I can't do this. I don't want to do this.
Yeah.
And Deshaun Foster's a saint for taking it over, but they're in a terrible spot.
It's a bad spot. I mean,
and all this to set up, like, that doesn't mean LSU's going to win 66-0.
Right, right. Yeah, no, I don't think that as well. I just, it's shocking just to see how out of touch UCLA football seems when this move to the Big Ten was going to give an advantage to the football program when you talk about money and resources. But when you dig in, you see economically that UCLA was about to have to shutter the doors on the athletic program. I mean, like, it was a losing proposition. And, you know, I don't know. I guess that's what all of this is, when Chip Kelly was barking for money and NIL and trying to, you know, have some type of presence within that space. And just he couldn't climb the mountain. He couldn't get there, and there was no support until finally he just said, "Look, I'm just going to go be an offensive coordinator. I'm just going to leave a sitting head coaching position chair at UCLA to go call plays at Ohio State." I mean, that was kind of earth moving, you know, within the coaching industry. That sent a hell of a message about where UCLA football is and the direction that it was going.
And it also is a tectonic shift in where LSU was then and to where they are now, because you lost to that UCLA team that Zach Charbonnet in the league, sure. But where LSU was at that point and where it feels like they are now, not a competition.
Yeah.
It didn't feel like it. And, like, I don't want to speak it out of turn, but I do feel like you can hang a number. And if you want to have this conversation about what do you want to see versus UCLA, I'm asking.
I think first and foremost, the offensive line needs to dominate the game. I think that's first what needs to come out.
Regardless of what the run fit is?
Yeah, no, I think obviously that's what the story has been on the offensive line in the run game, has been the scheme. That defenses have said to LSU, you're not going to push me around. We're just going to overstack the box. And, you know, I think that's played on. I will say that talking to people at LSU and, you know, watching more of the game, you can see that Caden Durham has been a great fit for this run style and what happened. They made a transition in that game, and they made a coaching move within that game, Davis, Kelly, and crew, of, you know, whatever was happening up front. They termed it combo blocking and what was happening, but they were moving guys around, and Durham came in and was able to bounce it and find the green, find the space, you know, make one guy miss, and he scored twice. And that really, you know, I think was more of how the run game is supposed to look. I mean, it's more of a patient, let the play blockers develop, and Durham really kind of saw that and was able to really shine in that type of role. And when you go back and watch it, I mean, Will Campbell's moving people. Yeah. Every successful play that happened Saturday in the run game happened off the left side. And when you go back and see what Dellinger and Campbell were doing in some instances, I mean, they were crushing people, burying people. Can Campbell play better and has to improve? Yeah, reputably, for sure. He's probably underperformed a bit, but in the totality of it, he's playing at a very, very high level.
And for Will Campbell's perspective, new center, new signal caller.
And I think without question that has some bearing on some of the growing pains that this offensive line has gone through here in 2024. Should they be going through growing pains? No. They have a combined over 100 starts together on the majority of that offensive line. But when you put a center into an offensive line as the one who's inexperienced, the one who doesn't have the amount of games started, the road experience, I'm not making excuses. DJ Chester's the guy. He's the center. He's the one that won out, and it's earned. He also doesn't have anyone behind him that you can look at and say, well, at least he has the experience to go in there and play, right? I mean, his backup is Eccles, the true freshman, who, you know, if he's to go in, you get younger. So, I mean, you don't want to take these steps backwards. I think Chester, this game, has a great opportunity to build some confidence as they move towards October, which we all know is pivotal points in this schedule of, you know, are you for real or not? You find out in October and can answer those questions. But until then, you have some things you need to tune up. You have some things you need to improve on. You have some things that you need to mentally get confident on. And I think DJ Chester fixable. Being in the middle, absolutely fixable. You know, I would want to kind of carry on from your question in point. Last week, the experiment with the new personnel, with the guys that stepped in there and played, Deshaun Spears at safety, P.J. Woodland at cornerback, seeing Harold Perkins play more of an outside linebacker role, those new roles, Parashan dropping down and playing more inside, I'd love to see more of that, continue to grow on that, allow those guys to get the confidence that it takes to really go play the month of October like we're talking about when the competition really kicks up a couple of clicks. And that's what I'm looking for this weekend when you talk about LSU.
And I talked – I'm going to steal a take here from Jared Mitchell because he was absolutely right. Where you see a lot of LSU – and you saw it late in the game where they made the adjustment of going – they're going a lot horizontally.
Mm-hmm.
And they did that early as opposed to use that like kind of like that horizontal motion to go vertically. And you saw that in the touchdown run with Josh Williams, wherever you saw the motion come across, boom, bang, it just sets your eyes a little bit differently. And the way that he was watching film after, like, we did this after the show, where he's like, look how much this changes, because he was looking at LSU's defense with what South Carolina was doing offensively when – like you get out of position for 1 second, you get your eyes inside one time, and you can bust it for 75. LSU wasn't doing that, and my point was, it's a double-edged sword. Is do you want to get going horizontally to be able to go vertical, or do you want to go vertical to get horizontal? And he was like, well, you have to establish the run at some point, and you know that you have athletes in space. Like you have Xavion Thomas, you have Aaron Anderson, that people have to have their eyeballs on. So use that as a little bit of, if you're not going to run Garrett Nussmeier, fake that as a motion before the play to be able to run the football. Because you have to get them one yeah. look.
Give them a step.
Just a step. Because you have athletes that can do it.
I think that's where you start to see the offensive playbook begin to develop a little bit in games and weekends like this.
You saw it late against South Carolina.
Joe Sloan has another great opportunity to really kind of, I don't say you use games to experiment. I just think you use games to work on things when they present opportunities like this. I think the first team offense and first team defense versus UCLA's first team offense and defense versus, you know, for LSU is very much advantage LSU come Saturday.
Both sides.
I mean, when it comes down to it, man on man, you can't really find a position where UCLA is marketably better. There's probably some cases where you could argue and you would hear it. Man on man, 11 on 11, LSU is extremely better than UCLA when they're coming in. When you know that as a coach, you go out, you execute, and you take care and be able to kind of put the opponent away, and then you begin to kind of work on some things that you may be looking for down the line. You don't tip, give, show anything on film, but whatever it may you know, kind of sound like, look like from a play calling standpoint, you know, you take these opportunities, these types of games to work on that. So, you know, this is another chance for Joe Sloan to really kind of improve on where he is at this point and working alongside Cortez Hankton as new offensive coordinator. So I think that this weekend gives a great chance for, you know, kind of things to work on. Yeah.
Because when you look at PFF, take it for what it is. I understand that people rank it, whether it's super high, like you live or die by it, as some people do, or you just kind of take some numbers from it that make sense. PFF has UCLA's run blocking rank 75th in the country and the pass protection at 95th. Garbers has been under pressure 31 times and taken 4 sacks in 2 games. UCLA runs a lot of screens, is what they're saying, but the biggest thing I would take from it, because from an LSU perspective, they average 2.7 yards a carry. That's against Hawaii and Indiana.
Yeah. Yeah.
Indiana's not bad, but
build some confidence.
But, you know, I think when you watch the football game, I think a lot of people are waiting for the big, like, run bust or what have you when LSU is on the defensive side. Like, don't give up the 65, 75-yard play. If you come away from that game and win by whatever the number is, 24, and you give up 10 points, I think people walk away happy. Because I don't think the question is on the offensive side. I think it's more of eliminate the big play defensively is where LSU feels like it stands right now. Don't let Lenora Sellers go 65 yards. Don't let Rocket Sanders go 55 yards on one play. If you're able to do that against UCLA, where they don't do that often, then you're making a markedly different improvement on what you're trying to change defensively, in my mind.
Yeah, I mean,
you don't want to see somebody go 80.
No, and I mean, that was too much last year. You know, was
well, and it's happening this year. It happened
big plays.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean,
it's one person out of position.
They have to tackle as well. You know, I mean, they had opportunities.
That's young guys in.
You know, Sage Ryan missed a big tackle in the open
new
field
position.
Saturday.
Five guys in new
That's
spots.
Fine. That's fine. I mean, I can hear tackling, you know, is not positionally. It's not,
a different run fit.
It is, but that was an open field tackle that they're missing on those long runs. You know, when we talk about the big play, a lot more big plays are given up on missed tackles than being out of position. You usually have a guy.
Line of assignment.
I hear you, but I have one thing I have been impressed with on Blake Baker's defense is that you've not had a lot of guys
Havoc.
That have been out of position or not known where they need to be, not known their
it's
responsibility.
Not scheme.
No, that's what I'm saying. That's what I'm saying. I'm saying that they have technically, I believe, and schematically, I believe LSU is they're prepared when they go into the games. They have a game plan per week. You know, there's nothing that says this is who LSU is defensively. They defend to try and shut down the strengths of what the opponent does. And we all agree that they need to find some upgraded personnel and some depth to be able to, you know, put opponents away like Saturday versus South Carolina, or allowing things to happen to them like early on in that game, going down 17-0, like they did. You know, I mean, for that to really kind of work itself out, you need some upgraded personnel and some depth to come in here. But with what you have, I believe LSU is prepared every week from a scheme standpoint. This guy's just got to go out there and make plays. You know, I mean, that's it kind of goes back to what we're talking about with what the issue really is with the defense is that, you know, I mean, you
Calvary's
like,
coming.
Like what Brian Kelly says, they play with who they play. You know, I mean, like, we play with who we play.
Every
you know
week I mean? is a new week.
Just kind of who
it's
you are.
A different week.
Yeah.
I mean, but, and I feel like he kind of put himself behind the eight ball a little bit by going, year three, judge me on year three, as opposed to, look at what he's had to replace because of what he came in with and thought his plan would work. And this isn't a knock on Brian Kelly, but he thought he could come in and do it the Notre Dame way. You bring in Steeples. You get rid of a lot of the old guard at LSU in your first year. You had Polian as your recruiting coordinator. You don't think Frank Wilson's better suited for that? Do you get Harlan Berry without Frank Wilson? Do you get Jakeem Stewart to reclassify and maybe come to LSU? I think a lot of those things, like, you almost have to judge him as this is year two, in my mind, or year one, when he has Corey Raymond back, Frank Wilson at the helm of recruiting. All of those things are total, like, he kind of figured it out a little bit whenever he was in war and going, I don't have the soldiers around me that I need to be able to get this job done.
Yeah, no, and look, we've talked about that. I mean, I think Brian Kelly's learned.
That's what I'm saying. He's learned. So, but he put out the year three statement, and a lot of people are judging him off of that.
I think he'd like to have that back.
1,000%.
You know, I mean,
every week's a new week.
Right. You know, it's,
3 years a new year.
It's. I think during that time he was just kind of saying, "Let me punt. Let me get. Just wait till year three." But now that we're here in year three. Hey,